Welcome back to the Deep State, this time with Patrick Dunlop from Jackal Labs. Super excited to have you on board. This episode is sponsored by Eclipse Labs. Eclipse is building Ethereum's fastest layer 2, powered by the Solana virtual machine. Eclipse contains Solana's performance and scalability, Ethereum's security. To get the best of both worlds, you can read more at eclipse.builders. We'll have a little bit more on them later in the show. Hey, before we get started, make sure you hit the like, subscribe, bell, all that stuff that helps break. That helps us bring great guests like Patrick to you. Dude, I'm a little tongue-tied today. Thanks for coming on, man. What's going on?
So just hanging out, man. It's just a lot of building during the bear market, you know. It's been a long road for us, but we're really happy with the state of everything, and it's been pretty wonderful.
Dig it. So Jackal, just to get into it, is this decentralized, super private storage stuff. But walk me through how you got there. Like, what brought you to Jackal Labs?
Oh, yeah. So before I was doing this, myself and my co-founder, we were working in digital forensics and investigations for law firms and corporations. And we were investigating re-entry attacks and kind of flash loan attacks on kind of exchanges, really, back in the index finance days and things like that. So that's how we got into it. And we were investigators. And then we got to a place where we were wanting to build a e-discovery tool for court. Was the start, right? So let's build this e-discovery tool. So what's great for track and trace of who has access to what things at what time? Blockchain, obviously. So we thought that we could attach digital files to the chain and then have proper chain of custody for evidence, which was really important. And it's a huge, huge space in general. When we were building that, we realized that there was no such thing as a self-custodial storage environment in the cloud where only the end user with the private key can access this, and kind of bring it back a little bit. That means that there's no clean forensic environment in the cloud. So when you use a cloud, for example, you give up self-custody and ownership because now you're on someone else's computer, basically.
Yep.
So we thought, in theory, is it possible for us to build this self-custodial cloud environment so you get the benefits of the scalability and the privacy while maintaining a clean forensic environment? And that led us to building this kind of open self-custodial storage layer in general, where we built two peer-to-peer networks. One's a DePIN network of storage providers. We're very, very young. So we have about 200 of them all around the world, from data centers to computers in people's basements. And then on the flip side, we have a blockchain where the second peer-to-peer network is the validators. And you can think of them as like the police of the network, where they make sure that the files are stored on the DePIN. Make sure that who has access to what files at what time, and transferring permissions and altering all that. So that's kind of how we got into the space originally. And we've been building since November 2021. We launched October of 2022, and we're just on our version 4 right now, and we're just continuing to scale.
Yeah, you guys are crushing. I was looking around, it's like the last time there was YouTube was I think November of 2022, so last year. So you guys have been head down and building super hard for a year. I see you come out with a bunch of other videos, but
yeah,
stuff. It's like a builder's build, right? That's the deal.
Yeah, it's we stopped the conference train. We laid off the YouTube a little bit so we could kind of really focus, and we scaled the team, and everyone's just grinding away for sure.
Cool. And you got a small team. Looks like there's 11 folks there. Working away on
Well, including contractors, we have 16 people full-time on stuff. So that's kind of where we are right now. Pretty much everyone's an engineer, and then we have two people. I'm kind of on the BD side of things now, and we have another individual that helps me with there. But everyone else, just full-on engineer, and just kind of chewing glass and staring into the abyss is a good way to put it, I guess.
Yeah, I guess.
The state of building blockchain technology.
There's a lot of work to have been done in the past year, and there's a lot of stuff that's about to come to fruition. So
100%.
Let's see. I guess one of the first questions that seems obvious to the kind of layperson is how do I trust that Jackal Labs is going to take my stuff and keep it secret or secure? Secure.
Secret, secure. Make sure that's always there because it's a deep, and obviously people can unplug their machines. So we built this thing. We didn't want Jackal to be a marketplace model, where on most kind of storage networks, there's a marketplace where you have, I want to make a deal with the storage provider and to maintain those deals and make sure that everyone, they're enforced, for example, that person doesn't unplug their machine and lose all my data, right?
Yep.
So what we did is we built two algorithms. One's called the internal detection of loss, and the other one is the Jackal proof of persistence protocol. And those are kind of the two things that we do. So the way that it works is that if you have a storage provider on the network and you're providing storage, Every X amount of time, you have to submit cryptographic proofs to the protocol through attestations that you continue to store that file. That's done by submitting like a 1 kilobyte encrypted chunk of it to say, yep, I still have the file. The validator set verifies that. And in the event that you submit the proper proof, they pay you, right? So that's kind of how that operates, and that you'll be paid in Jackal tokens as the reward. In the event that, say, a provider, they're malicious and they say, you know, I don't really want to be a Jackal storage provider anymore. I'm going to unplug this from the wall. What will happen is the Jackal protocol always has 3 times redundancy for every file in the network. So if you unplug, you'll miss a specific proving window. If you miss it, I think it's 2 or 3 proving windows in a row, that storage deal is broken. In the event that that happens, that storage deal is now open, that another provider on the network will grab that file, they'll copy it from the other forms of redundancy, and then they'll rebind that contract. So it's kind of like a storage whack-a-mole in a weird way, so that you always ensure that you have 3 times redundancy. Yeah.
Nice. All right. And then I guess you're only getting a part of the file. So if I put something up in my little server closet, I'm not getting, you know, someone's entirety of their documents. I'm just getting some little piece of it.
Yeah. That's the thing that we really wanted to focus on, right? It's really hard to have, everyone says like enterprise use cases or Web2 use cases, but it is true in the sense that right now in the storage landscape, no one was really focusing on 2 things. One was like hot storage. So you have like the speeds of like web scale applications or things like that. It was more for like, we have this big data set and we need to put it somewhere and it's all public information. So we'll store it. And if we need it, then it will be really hard to retrieve it, but we got it back eventually. It might take 24 hours, but we'll get it. So we want to focus on speed and privacy. So the way that the Jackal protocol works is we have on-chain permissions for the files themselves. So your public and private key pair is actually also your private key is the decryption key for the file. So if you have a provider or a machine in your storage provider to the network, you can't access the files that are on that computer at all because you don't have the encryption key for those files, right? Okay. So that's how that operates really. And that's the one thing. The other thing is that they file trees, right? So on a lot of storage networks, if you query the blockchain, if they have on-chain permissions, it's like reading someone's finder on their Mac, for example. Yeah, you can go and they can read all the stuff. So we encrypt the file trees as well. So no one really has access or knows what you're storing on the protocol at all, depending obviously on a bunch of other things, depending on what your OPSEC is. You have the option, you want to store privately, you can encrypt locally and then push it. Or if you want it public and you want to publish something, or you want like to publish a markdown file or something like that, you can actually publish that as well.
Ah, cool. So you can do it both ways. Nice.
Yeah, that's the benefit of we chose to build a Cosmos blockchain. So we're really into the modular thesis where kind of there's 2 ways to scale in blockchain technology. There's vertical where you just keep on rolling up, you have the L2s, and you have the L3s. And the other option is like horizontal scalability. So we think that every app should have its own blockchain, and then you can interoperate with kind of different protocols like that. I don't want to get too technical, but at the end of the day, application-specific blockchains lost the ability to alter the blockchain consensus at its core. And this means that every single blockchain module we can change. So we have the file trees built into the blockchain, the storage module, storage deals built into the chain directly. So we get like a little bit of a scalability boost and all kinds of things like that. So it's the modular thesis. It gives us a lot of flexibility.
Dig it. And I guess, you know, that the whole thing kind of proves out over the next couple of years, nobody knows exactly what's
that's for sure.
In fact, speaking of that, let's take a quick break and we'll talk about today's sponsor, Eclipse Labs. One of the cool parts about doing this show is we get to talk to tons of projects across the space, including back-end nerdy stuff that helps deepen projects. One of those is today's show sponsor, Eclipse Labs, who's building Ethereum's fastest layer 2 to support several deepen projects. Eclipse leverages the best parts of the modular stack, Solana for execution, Celestia for scalability, and Ethereum for security. Eclipse is committed to helping projects build on deepen. Check them out at eclipse.builders and check out the interview we did with Neil at Eclipse if you haven't seen yet. So it's funny because that's just a different thing than the way you guys are doing it. I think it's really cool to see how all of these different kind of experiments are being conducted. And because there's no clear path forward, there's only a clear path in reverse. It's going to be super cool to kind of see how it shakes out.
It's pretty fascinating in general. And just looking at all the different consensus engines, now you have the Move blockchains coming out, right? You have the Aptos, the Sui's. There's Movement Labs that are building on Celestia with the data availability. And then there's Solana just has this big DePIN movement. And then some people, it really just depends on your thesis and what technology you had at the time, right, as well. So when we started building, we thought that the best way to do that was building our own L1. And that was kind of back in 2021.
Yep.
So luckily, what I'm excited for is the next wave of applications coming in, building on things like Celestia, building on things like Eclipse, and kind of like having that modularity, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So I walk think me through. We're all kind of converging.
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, we'll figure out the answer. Walk me through what you're thinking for the next 6 months, where you see Jackal Labs going.
Maybe
what you're excited about.
Yeah, there's all kinds of things that we're excited about. There's number one, so we built this crazy DePIN storage network and then blockchain, and it's all live, it's all stable, which is beautiful. It took us a long time to get to that, but we're really happy with the current way that it is right now, right? The next thing for us is we want anyone that's building on any blockchain to be able to access scalable decentralized storage with a simple contract call. So for us to be able to do this, we have this outpost model that we're starting to build, where we can build these smart contract outposts on other blockchains. Mm-hmm. And if I'm a builder and I don't want to use like Amazon Web Services, or I want to use an Azure environment, or I don't want like API spaghetti in the background, it would be wonderful if I could just have a simple contract call, just get access to completely scalable, and you can be public or private, have all kinds of usability for that, unlocking all kinds of different verticals, whether it's decentralized science, other DePIN networks, team places even. So it really depends on kind of what you're building. So that's the number one, is this outpost model. Number two is another really important thing that we think, we've been asked about it a lot recently from people that are using the product, also from people that we've been chatting to, just in general advisors, is having the ability for smart contracts to read and write to off-chain data. So the DePIN network being off-chain, quote-unquote, mm-hmm. where you have this ability to have a file stored, and then you can update or read from that file using a smart contract. That's also really interesting, where now you have a lot more programmability on the blockchain level itself. So think about if you're a DePIN network and you're collecting data from geolocation for paragliding, for example, right? Mm-hmm. For example, you could have a smart contract on, let's say that you're on an EVM that can actually update that specific location to a storage network that can integrate directly on chain, rather than kind of having this workaround that we all have to do right now. So we think that's fascinating as well.
Huh. Ah, super cool. Super cool. All right. And then
all kinds of different stuff. Yeah.
It's just nonstop. And I think that with all of these projects, the deeper you go, like the more you kind of figure out, okay, this is where this thing plugs into the next piece, and this is how this, you know, connects not only this thing to, quote, the real world, but also across these different DePIN projects. So it's cool to see you guys thinking about that. Oh, maybe we store information for other DePINs.
100%. And we're getting like that much closer to it, because you look at kind of like the last run, right? Everyone started like building, and there's so much competition from DeFi project to DeFi project, from NFT marketplace to NFT marketplaces, that a lot of people didn't build the proper infrastructure to do what they were trying to do. And it kind of lost, they lost the narrative a little bit, and no one kind of went back and built the boring cryptography. And it's beautiful to see that now with all like the general message passing and the cross chain, the inter blockchain communication protocol, actually, GPT. There's guys called Union Build that are bridging just packets. As long as we can get like a packet back to the blockchain itself, that means that we can update the storage accounts and update the file trees and do all that wonderful stuff. It's pretty beautiful at the end. It's all slowly converging, and we're getting there.
It's rad to see. So here we are a year into kind of the official, or if you're a year after the official kind of launch, maybe a year in.
Mm-hmm.
Is the network big enough? Is it, you know, should I kind of run out and go buy a miner and help you guys out? Does it matter? Do you have enough storage? Do you need more? Like, what do people do to support and participate in the community?
Best way to participate is number one, join the Discord, really. Is we're a Discord shop, so a lot of people would like to get support there. We have an awesome storage provider community in general. There's about 200 of them right now across the world that are kind of doing all their stuff together.
Okay.
That's beautiful. The other thing is that we're having an economics upgrade as well. So all that stuff is in our forms, which you can access from our website. And that upgrade is probably going to go into effect in the next few months. So that will change. The storage providers are going to get a stipend, plus you get real yield from storage payments and things along those lines. The current state of the network is we have about 5 petabytes of data storage available right now. Yeah, so we have a lot of storage now. It's kind of like when you build this marketplace, you have the supply side and the demand side, right? So the supply side, awesome about blockchain is you can bootstrap these wonderful communities really quickly. So now it's really focusing on the demand side.
Yep.
So if you want to be involved with the Jackal protocol and you say, I'm not that technical, because it takes a decent amount of technical knowledge to manage one of these providers, and it's not easy, as I'm sure you know. But the other thing is that now we have a name service built into the chain, so everyone can have referral codes as well. So if you want to do referrals, say, hey, I have a business and we need a backup to protect us from ransomware, for example, and say like, hey, geo redundancy is expensive and we would love to have another place to store our data. Using that code is you get 25% kickbacks from the storage payments themselves, which is wonderful. So there's all kinds of ways to participate. You can get involved from actually participating in the DePIN network. You can participate in our other peer-to-peer network, which is a validator, or just as a community member, you say, hey, I would love to onboard as much data as possible, and I can get incentivized to do that as well.
Cool. Dig it, dude. Well, we'll put a link down to the Discord in the show notes, but thanks a ton for coming on and walking us through what's going on with Jackal. Appreciate your time.
I really appreciate it, Nick. Thanks for having me.